asking that. One more thing, in case you are getting trouble reading all this, then you can mail me on this ID. It's vibhash.34@gmail.com. That reminds me, I'm called Vibhash. I'm sorry, I forgot introducing myself. You know, that's my name. So it's what mail you can mail me. And just in case you don't get a reply after a day and a half, please send the mail back to me. It's just that I receive around 550-600 mails in a day, and I'm not getting any younger anymore. So, you know, in that case, I'm disappointed. Okay. So, send it to me again, I'll definitely respond. In a day and a half or so, I do respond to the questions that you ask me. In case you want to see me for some personal discussions, then after your class every day, I have my optional class at 11 at main office Vajiram, main building. So, in case you want to discuss, you can often find me there at 10:45. After your class, you'll see me there. So in case you need some help from my side there, you can always come along. And I repeat again, the differences can be there, the difference of opinions can be there, because we can be differently trained people. I have been trained in a way. I did my master's from Delhi School of Economics long back. Dinosaurs were moving in those days. 1997, I passed out my master's. 2001, my PhD got over from Washington State University. And my wife is also an economist. She did her PhD from Kolkata University. And she still believes that socialist policies can bring a lot of growth to India. So all of us do mistakes, I'm okay with it. Thank you for getting the joke. It gives me satisfaction to get the joke. You know, my sarcasm is intense. What am I doing? Anyway, so be careful there. Now, yes.
People say that we need to make notes, economics notes from these books. But as I read the newspaper, it becomes very tough and extraneous job to find out and make notes.
Yes.
So what to do?
Maybe I don't know whether I'm the right person to answer it or not, because I never consciously prepared for UPSC in my life. I've always been an academician. But I still believe that making notes is, at least in economics topic, is not a very useful exercise, especially given that you will be getting current affairs material from the institute anyways. You know? And if you compare the current affairs material that the institute gives you and with the notes that you have made, you will see that there will be 80% overlap, maybe 20% things they include which you must have left, and 20% things you would include that they may have left. So for that 20%, I don't think it's worth giving half an hour of life or 1 hour of life for that. So my suggestion is that you read through your newspapers. If you see an important article that seems important to you, maybe you can take a paper cutting of that if you want. But end of the day, many articles become redundant over the period. You know, like all the foreign exchange debate that's happening these days will become redundant as the exchange rate comes back to normal. Alright, so then the debate that has to be kept in mind is how to maintain the exchange rate in a stable position. That debate, in any case, this classroom will do with you. She will teach you that, but people will teach you about that. You know? So if you ask me, my belief is that if you make those notes, that should be a personal call. If you feel no notes make you comfortable, make them. But those notes will not be majorly helpful. Alright, but honestly speaking, it's a personal call. Ultimately, all of us are different people and we go by our own ways. Some people remember things like God has been kind to me, I remember data very nicely. So in that case, I never required learning data, I never required revising them, but somehow it just remained stuck with me. Always. So help me as an economist. But then I see many others who keep a data profile and keep it in their tower always, and then they speak. So it's about individuals. You know? So if you ask me, it's a difficult one to answer. But my belief is that rather than making all those notes, you can rely on the current affairs to give you that. Vajiram will be giving you that. Alright. So we come back to our problem. So when we say, what is an economy? We write an answer and we proceed. We write any space, and this space can be real or virtual, as in cyberspace, e-commerce, or it can be real space the way we are talking to each other. So any space with a defined set of rules, and institutions to implement those rules, is called an economy. Now see, I deliberately gave you a broader definition for economy because I want my classroom to understand that economy is beyond only market, and it is beyond only commercial activities. So then it will be any place that you see with a defined set of rules. So defined set of rules in the sense that that is how you distinguish economic systems. Like say when you say Indian economy, or Chinese economy, or American economy, then one way in which we distinguish them is the different set of rules and regulations they will have. Like say tax laws. Tax laws can be different in India, and tax laws can be different in US, and different in China, and so on. So that's one way to identify, okay, this is a different economic system from the other. Say contract enforcement laws. So they can be different in different places, and that creates an economic system. That is one. And that is why economies are not only national economies. You can have economies of state, like say Punjab's economy can be different from Tamil Nadu's economy, and Tamil Nadu's economy can be different from Maharashtra's economy, and so on. And you can have economies of even cities, like Delhi's economy, and Mumbai's economy, and Chennai's economy. And similarly, even economies for individual places within cities. So Karol Bagh's economy is dependent on migrant students living in Karol Bagh. This statement is true. But the same cannot be held true about, say, Connaught Place's economy. You understand that? So different places can define an economy for themselves depending on different rules and regulations they have, different parameters on which they are working, and institutionalization. That's the next thing I made you write, that there is a set of institutions to implement these rules. So institutions will be what? Any organization which has a defined objective. Let's say our school is an institution, our parliament is an institution, our police is an institution. So institutionalization is important because that gives you continuity. If things are not institutionalized, then they are not continuous. I'll give you an example. Because if they are not institutionalized, then they are discretionary. Then they are based on one individual choosing to do what they want to do. Take an example. Suppose one of you gets up, says what a boring lecture, takes a knife, puts it in my stomach, and collapses. No, I'm not giving you ideas. Now, you know, normally speaking, what will happen is somebody will call the police. The police will come, hopefully, and they arrest the person, present him to a court, The court will then decide whether to acquit or convict the person based on, say, the proofs that they have. But remember, here it is not important who the policeman is, because we have a set of rules under which the person has to work. And similarly, it's not important who the judge will be, because again, the judge has a set of rules under which we have to work, decided by the legislature, which itself works under the set of rules. This is institutionalized system. That you have institutions to do things where individuals don't matter. But imagine if the same incident takes place in a Taliban warlord-controlled area. And there, I'm presented in front of the warlord. And the warlord is the executive, judiciary, legislature combined. And his mood that day decides whether I'm acquitted or convicted. You know, this is discretionary. One person deciding what has to be done. When things are institutional, they are continuous. Because even if one person goes away, since it's institutionalized, systems will continue. What I'm trying to teach you is that economies can be there without institutions. But such economies are tough to define, because they won't have set of rules which are consistent. All right. So an economy can be well defined when they have a set of rules and they have institutions to implement those rules, which will bring a semblance of continuity to them. All right. So that is how we talk about economy. And the study of economy is what we will call economics. All right. That is the study of economy that we talk about. Like when you read your NCERT, they say it's oikos and nomos, comes from the Greek word and so on. That's okay. Fine. But end of the day, when you study different economic systems, you're studying economics. All right, like in your UPSC preparation, more or less we try preparing you on Indian economic system that we have, all right, and the way we function and so on. Now, we take the next question, we go further.
Right.
What are economic activities? What are economic activities? Again, you write, and then we discuss it. Right. All those activities which create value, and which can be measured. I'm repeating myself. All those activities which create value and which can be measured are called economic activities are called economic activities. They include production. So production is any activity which converts a raw material into finished product or inputs into output. That's production. Comma, consumption. In economics, we give a broader term to consumption. That's utilization. Anything that we use is consumed. Alright, normally in layman terms, when we say consumed, then it means we have taken it in, you know. But here in economics, we can consume a board and we can consume a chair. So don't get scandalized, it's about utilizing it. Alright, so production, consumption, exchange. What does exchange connote? Presence of a market. Alright, whether barter system, that is exchanging commodities or exchanging for money. But presence of a market, that's exchange. And distribution. Production, consumption, exchange, and distribution. Now see, distribution is a broader term. Distribution means that it can be through the market. That is, the way you take commodities produced to the people. That's distribution. So it can be through the market. Like, I go to the market, buy this marker. So the marker was distributed by the market to me as I paid for it. Alright? But it can be outside the market also, like say a government providing free education to children. Alright, that is also a part of distribution. But free education, so why are we calling it an economic activity? It's free. Or I reframe my question, is it for free? Because there is a resource cost involved. Government will take a land, piece of land that is, and government will build a building on it. As school building, the government will hire teachers and the non-teaching staff, and the government will then say buy stationery and other materials and then provide this teaching as a, or schooling as a facility. So there is resource cost for all of that is getting involved. The only thing is that the students don't have to pay for it. But students don't have to pay for it doesn't mean government doesn't have to spend anything on it. And that is why nothing is free. We call it in economics, we say there is no free lunch. So there is no free lunch because everything has an opportunity cost. Alright, now when we use the term opportunity cost, opportunity cost is cost of sacrificing second best alternative. That is opportunity cost. Cost of sacrificing second best alternative. Of course, second best because the assumption is that the best alternative will be chosen by you. Alright, so take an example. Suppose I say Vajiram gives me 20 rupees for taking it. And if I don't take this class, the other option is that I can stand outside to manage this classroom and then I will be paid 15 rupees. Then say I choose to take this class because that's the best I get. Then the second best was 15 rupees. So 15 rupees becomes the opportunity cost for me of taking this class. The cost of sacrificing the second best to take. Now take it in government context. When government chooses to provide this school to children free of cost, then with the same resources, government could have, or the same money could have been used by the government to provision other things like say food to 100 families or healthcare facilities. So they become the opportunity cost of providing this food. And government bears this opportunity cost by giving up the other activities they could have done with the same money. Do I believe I'm reaching you on this? So when you look at this context, please understand, that is why the way you distribute is very important with respect to how you are targeting it and who are the beneficiaries of it, you know? Because everything that you are giving has an opportunity cost. It's not coming for free. I'll give you a few instances, you'll get my point. And I'm trying to teach you the idea of distribution. Just putting few ideas of inclusive growth in your mind along with that. I will be teaching you inclusive growth in future. So in my first class, I keep putting some theories in your mind on inclusive growth or liberalization and globalization? Because these are topics I will be covering with you, infrastructure, topics on oil pricing and other hydrocarbon pricing in India and so on. We'll be doing it over the period, even the economic structure of India as it evolved between 51 to 91, the planning period and so on. So we will be discussing that. But just putting it to you, think now, take since we are in Delhi, our government provides subsidy on electricity to all for consumption needs, all right? And the total bill of that electricity subsidy last year to our government was 324 crore rupees. Now who will get this subsidy? It will be available to all who have a metered electricity connection. But who will have a metered electricity connection? Those who have an assured housing, rented or owned, but it should be an assured housing. But then according to Delhi State Development Report, 34 lakh people in Delhi, approximately 20% of the population of Delhi, are people who were not having assured accommodation. So there are people who are living on, say, footpath, or people who are sleeping in their rickshaw, at best living in a slum. None of these places have an assured electricity connection or metered electricity connection. So these people get automatically out of this subsidy. It's not reaching them while they are relatively poorer. And which kind of poor get this subsidy also, apart from the middle class and so on? Very poor people like me, they will also get this subsidy. So that is where targeting is an issue. Because if I am getting that subsidy, then that kind of subsidy, and the very poor is not getting that subsidy, I can believe subsidy is understood by us, the grants given by government. Then that kind of subsidy will increase inequality rather than reducing it. Because it's adding to my capacity and it's not adding anything to the capacity of the poor. Then we can keep saying, oh, what's happening in my economy? Why is it unequal? You're kind of making it. Take the recent episode. We said that we will be giving minimum support price on 1.5 times the cost of production to our farmers. Perfect. And then the agricultural minister said that it's a historical decision and so on and so forth. That's another request. When we are discussing things in the classroom, when you enter this, please keep your political beliefs outside the door. That door, I don't mind. But kindly keep them outside the door. Because if political beliefs remain stuck up, then rather than analyzing again, you will become defensive or offensive based on your liking or disliking. That should not happen. See, having political beliefs is nice in a democracy. It makes the democracy dynamic and thriving. But if political beliefs start interfering in your professional analysis, it's catastrophic. Because then it is not professional analysis, then it is bhakti. So we won't do any devotion kind of a thing. And by chance, if I hurt any of your sentiments, my apologies in the first class itself. So I will be committing some sacrilege, I know. But coming to the point here again, so think now, 324 crore rupees in electricity on this, take this farm subsidy, minimum support price. So okay, maybe I can agree with the government that right, giving a higher minimum support price will help the poor farmers and the marginal farmers. But what worries me is when I read Economic Survey 2016-17 Volume 2, the chapter on agriculture, it says 41% farmers don't know that there is something like MSP which exists. And who will be these 41%? Those who are poor, marginal, and living on subsistence farming. So then if you increase 1.5 times MSP, you are not reaching them. And whom can you reach? Those who can be big farmers, who can have large land holdings and are doing business in your economic system. In fact, those of us who understand Indian agriculture, over a period you will understand it even better, even if you don't right now. And again, Shyam will teach you that topic. But those of us who already understand few things know very well that most of this gain will not go to the farmers, but to the traders. Because most of our agricultural markets are controlled by traders and not farmers don't have much say in it. So till we don't do those reforms, no matter how much extra MSP you give, minimum support price, the farmers won't gain very much out of that. What will it do? The already rich traders and the rich farmers, because farming is no more a homogeneous group. Farmers are heterogeneous in India. They can range from the very poor farmers, marginal farmers, which can be in majority, no doubt about it, to middle level farmers, which are also large number, but then few but very dominant large farmers who can have BMWs and Audi to their disposal. You just have to visit villages in Punjab and Haryana. You realize what I'm talking. So in that case, these farmers getting help is nobody's business. But once you start giving this MSP, you can't seclude them. And if you can't seclude them, then again I repeat, inequality rises rather than falls. Then maybe 15 years later, you can say under neoliberal regime, due to all these problems, our inequality has increased. No, it has increased maybe due to our faulty policies on subsidization also. So, you know, distribution becomes a complex issue there. So when we distribute, especially outside the market, we have to be careful that targeting is correct, and then that method of distribution is dynamic, so that more and more people can be covered under it, those who are actually in need of it. You know, just put it in your mind, we'll discuss it better as we go ahead. So that is why, you know, when we talk about distributional aspects of an economy, it is important to understand, first of all, the distribution of powers in your economic system. You know, and then only you can understand, okay, how can we distribute things better. The things like electricity subsidy in Delhi or even water bill subsidy in Delhi are typical examples of wrong distributional techniques, you know, that we use. It doesn't help poor as much. Yeah, the improvement in government schooling in Delhi will actually help the poor. Because when you improve government schools in Delhi, then it will mean that poor can afford now and send their children over there. And as their children can sustain themselves, they don't have to drop out because they get better support from their teacher. And if they can do some good results and go after into the upper level of education, then education can be the uplifting force, you know, for them. So that can work for equity. But giving subsidy on electricity, well, okay, poor people like me are happy anyways. You can get those subsidies. But that is to be contented. Okay, we take the story further then. We take a question, you write. What is, yeah, one more thing before I give you the question. When you say economic activities, one way to distinguish it from non-economic activities is knowing what are non-economic activities. And there are only two things which are classified as non-economic. One is when we talk about the illegal activities. All illegal activities are non-economic. Okay, that is a non-economic activity. Because illegal activities, if I have identified them, then I will not count them as a part of my GDP. I would rather try stopping them. So all illegal activities are non-economic. And all amateur activities are non-economic. Amateur activities are generally services for self-consumption. They are non-economic. Like if I'm teaching my own son, then that's a non-economic activity. Because we can't put a value on it. That's a problem. Similarly, if a doctor is treating her own father, then she's doing a value addition, but that can't be counted. And that is why that is taken as a non-economic activity or services of a housewife. See, point is, all these things create value. You know, if I'm teaching my son or a doctor is teaching her father or a housewife is doing services at home, then this is creating value. The issue is you can't have value is ascribed to it, that is measurement is not possible. And since measurement is not possible, then it is taken as a non-economic activities. So ideally, we would like to keep them economic activities, but due to lack of measurement facilities, we call them non-economic activities. All right, and the first one, when I said illegal, it's the legality. It has nothing to do with ethics there. It's legal or illegal. So gambling, if legal, is economic activity. If illegal, is non-economic activity. All right, so whenever we have to distinguish what is non-economic, keep it as two rules there. Illegal activities are non-economic, and amateur services for self-consumption is non-economic. Commodity production for self-consumption is economic. If a farmer grows potato and eats it himself, then we can find the value of those potato, assign value to it, and that's an economic activity. All right, that's not non-economic. But that is how we distinguish between them. Then you take this, you write, what is gross domestic product? Next question you write, please. Creating a value means adding something to the existing system in terms of a positive value creation of either commodity or service. Alright, when you create a commodity or when you provide a service, then you are creating value. Alright, for which you can charge or you may not charge money, but the value creation is happening. Alright, that is the idea of creating value, that you are either producing a product, commodity or a service for people. Alright, that's value creation. Alright. When we say gross domestic product, we'll keep calling it GDP hereafter. You write a definition again and we will discuss it. So what is gross domestic product? Right? Gross domestic product is, gross domestic product is total value of final goods and services. So goods are nothing but commodities, you know, the tangibles that create value for us, like clothes are goods and chair is a good and board is a good. So all tangibles, commodities are goods. And services are non-tangibles that give us value. Like if I take a taxi, go from one place to another, then I get a service of transportation. I don't own the car and I have not hired the driver, but I've got the service of transportation which has taken me from one place to another. Or if we use a hospital, we get the service of healthcare. Alright, so the non-tangibles are called services which create value for us. So total value of final goods and services produced in domestic territory of an economy in a given accounting year or financial year, in a given accounting year or financial year. I repeat again, GDP is total value of final goods and services produced in domestic territory of an economy in a given accounting year or financial year. And that is how we define GDP. So if we understand these three terms, we can then start understanding what is gross domestic product, and then we'll talk about the relevance of it and so on. So when we say financial year or accounting year, see, the year over which government presents its budget is called financial year. Right, that is called a financial year. Like in Indian context, it starts from 1st April of a year and ends on 31st March of the other year. Like when we say year 2017-18, so 2017-18 is 1st April 2017 to 31st March 2018. So April to March is the financial year we use in India, and we divide this financial year into four quarters. Alright, this financial year is divided into four quarters. So first quarter is April to June, second quarter is July to September, third is October to December, and fourth is January to March. That is 3 months each that we put it in. And we estimate our gross domestic product both annually and quarterly. Alright, the gross domestic product is estimated both annually and quarterly. And the estimate is done, this I want you to take down. GDP is estimated in India by Central Statistical Organization. GDP is estimated in India by Central Statistical Organization CSO is or what we call it, under Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Under Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Okay, so coming back to financial year, this financial year of April to March was introduced by the Britishers in India in 1867. And since then we have been following April to March. Since 1984, a debate was initiated that how about shifting the financial year in India to January to December, that is merging the financial year with calendar year. Alright, now this debate picked up big time in the last 4 years. Niti Aayog presented a paper on this, and they said that there are two advantages if we can shift financial year from April-March to January-December. One advantage they said was, most of our trading partners take January to December as financial year. So if India also shifts to that, it will bring more convergence in our data and their data, making it easier for us to understand each other. Alright, that was one thing that was said, that if we shift to January to December, then our data set and their data set will converge better and will be easier to understand each other. They also said that it has another advantage. In a country like India, where financial literacy of people is relatively lesser, it will be more convenient for people if there is a one single year, calendar and financial. So then people can then you know, narrate to it and identify it that, okay, January to December is the year, finally. And they don't have to worry about different years for finance and for normal year. But, and government gave an in-principle approval to it. Government said, right, we will shift from April, March to January to December. But we have not yet done it for a reason, because there are two issues involved. If we shift from April to March to January to December, then one will be, we will need administrative preparation to a large extent. I'll tell you in what sense. Today, when we have April to March here, then we present the budget on 1st February and get it passed by March, so that by April the funds can be disbursed. But if you shift it to January to December, then the budget will have to be presented on 1st November to be passed by December, so that funds can be disbursed by 1st January. That will mean the budget preparation will have to begin sometimes in June, July. And that will mean you will need all your data about your economic system by June, July. Today we get them by December, January. You know, so that administrative preparation will be needed, that you collect your data beforehand and put it for budget evaluation. Also, different departments will have to present their individual budgets and coordinate it among themselves, you know. And then different ministries across departments will have to do that coordination. So all that will need some preparation on administration side. And that will take longer time than just announcing that we are shifting to January to December. And then the second issue is, information campaign will have to be tremendous, because we are again large, diverse. So everybody will have to be informed that this is shifting. See, today what happens? Since it is April to March, most of the tax filings is in the last quarter, that is January to March. Most of the companies assess their income in the last quarter. Most of the individuals pay their taxes or show their transactions in the last quarter. Now all this last quarter will shift from January to March to October to December. So everybody will have to make this adjustment of shifting 3 months ahead. And hence they need to be informed much in advance so that they can make this adjustment well in advance. Now since our economy has already gone through two disruptions, demonetization and GST, so then throwing another one was not conducive. So the government has gone slow on that. Alright, so that is why we have not done it, even though Madhya Pradesh government has become the first state government to announce that they will be shifting to January to December. In fact, the announcement was that they will be shifting from 2018 itself, but till now they have not notified it. Alright, but that was the announcement made last year, that from 2018 Madhya Pradesh will shift to January to December accounting year. But then that notification has not been issued as yet, so we don't know whether they are going to do that exactly or not. But this is where we stand at the moment. Alright, that on this debate. Now I can repeat it for you. Tell me this. I can believe we have a normal understanding of April to March as being the financial year or the accounting year. That is year over which government presents its budget. And the recommendations of Niti Aayog are that we can shift to January to December as accounting year, mainly for two reasons. Brings more convergence between India's and its trading partners' data collection, and provides more convenience to people as it removes the needless distinction between accounting year and financial and the calendar year. And the problems are, A, administrative preparation will have to be huge, and financial and information campaigns will have to be tremendous. So as long as we don't do that, that is why government has approved it but not yet implemented it. Since this debate has become a little downplayed now, so I'm discussing it just peripherally with you. But I can believe that if you see anything in newspaper here onwards, you will get an idea, okay, this is the debate above. So keep an eye on it. You just might see a few things happening on this. But only after the elections now. Then we take things further. When we say final goods and services, you know, like we understood what is financial year, accounting year. When we say final goods and services, this is classified by what we say use-based classification of goods and services. So we categorize different commodities and different services on the basis of their usage, and we call it use-based classification. And there are three categories we create in this. So one category is consumer goods and services. Consumer goods and services. Again, we are trying to understand what kind of goods and services are final goods and services. Don't forget, we define GDP as total value of final goods and services produced in domestic territory in a given accounting year. So I can believe that my classroom understands what is accounting year. I'm now trying to explain to you what are final goods and services. All right, so we say that we classify the commodities on use-based classification, and within that, the first category is consumer goods and services. You take a line again and you go ahead, you write, all those goods and services, this is consumer goods and services, all those goods and services which are used for ultimate satisfaction and not for further production are called consumer goods and services. So you know the clothes we wear, or the car we drive, or the refrigerator at our house, these are all consumer goods and services. We are using them for ourselves, or okay, our own usage. They are consumer goods and services. Electricity we use at our own place is a consumer service. All right, that kind of a thing. The second category is capital goods. You write all those goods which are used for further production of goods and services over a long period of time. All those goods which are used for further production of goods and services over a long period of time are called capital goods. Now please understand this. I said a car that we use for ourselves is a consumer good, but a car which is used to run a taxi service will be a capital good because it is used to provide further services. Similarly, a refrigerator in our house is a consumer good, but a refrigerator kept by a shopkeeper to provide retailing service by storing commodities in it becomes a capital good. Understood the point? So, same commodity can be consumer good or capital good depending on how it has been used. That is why we call it use-based classification. Alright? Similarly, this boat can be a capital good for Vajiram, because this boat, it can be used over a long period of time for providing the services of education. Like when I was teaching last batch, the boat was there. I'm teaching you, the boat is there. Believing me and you remain normal, it will be there for next batch. So considering that, it is a long-term thing. The screens we see in this room, television screens, are again capital goods for Vajiram. So all those goods which help you in further production over a long period of time, when government constructs a road, that's again a capital good. All right, so they are used. The term used is capital goods. They add to my production capacity. All right. Consumer goods are those which are used by individuals for themselves, their own use. Yes. You had a question.
If the goods are used by us, are we sold again? Like our cars and homes.
Right. They are second-hand goods. They are not part of GDP because they were part of GDP when they were already produced in the first year. Yeah, second-hand goods have no role, no? Because we have to talk about commodities produced in the given accounting. This commodity would have been produced in some other accounting. Okay, this is the second-hand transaction where exchange of ownership is happening. Nothing new is being produced. Okay. Then you write one more line to this, same capital goods only. You write, addition to the stock of capital goods is called investment. Addition to the stock of capital goods is called investment. I'm trying to teach you something here. What I'm trying to teach you is that whenever we use the word investment in economics, then we are implying that it is some new commodity purchased which will be used for further production of goods and services. Like what happens is, in layman terms, we use the word investment even when we buy a financial asset. Like when we say that I invested 10,000 rupees in a share, or I invested 15,000 rupees in a bond, or I invested 100 rupees in a fixed deposit, you know. But these are financial assets. In economics, they are not taken as investment, they are taken as savings. All right, they are not investment. So whenever we are studying economics, we say all financial investments, the financial asset creation, is savings. All right, it's investment only when the funds are used to buy a commodity, which is a capital good. That is commodity which will be used to produce further goods and services. So a factory buying a machine is investment. An airline company buying an aircraft is an investment. But if I am buying shares of a company, that's saving rather than investment. I can believe that can stay with us. So please keep it in mind in that sense. There is one exception here. If there is an individual who buys a house even for his own living, then we create an exception, we still call it investment. So housing is the only investment which even the individuals can do, even if it is for self-occupation. All right, if I buy a house, then that is considered as investment in economics. It is said that houses will last you 70 years, 80 years. So they are unlike other consumer durables. A car or a refrigerator, if bought by a consumer, used for himself, that will be a part of consumption. But house purchased by someone, even for self-consumption, like living himself in that, will be still treated as investment. And that's the only exception. There's no other exception to that, all right? So housing is an investment. All other consumer durables are taken as consumption if purchased by individuals. Any commodity which is otherwise used for further production of goods and services will be called a capital good. Any addition to capital good is called an investment. So I can believe we distinguish between investments and savings in general. Or then you take the next thing. You write intermediate goods and services. That's the third category. Intermediate goods and services. Intermediate goods and services. You write a line again. You write all those goods and services which are used for further production of goods and services for sale in the market, and which get completely exhausted, during production process. Are called intermediate goods and services. You know, in a layman language, raw materials are intermediate goods. You know, all things that we use as raw materials are intermediate goods. Like, take for example this. Suppose a person buys milk 30 rupees and sugar say 20 rupees, produces tea, sells it in the market for 100 rupees. Then milk and sugar will become intermediate goods. Alright, they were the raw materials, ingredients used in making tea which was sold in the market. That's important. If it is not sold in the market, then all the three are consumption goods. If I use milk, tea, milk, sugar, make tea and drink it myself, then milk, sugar, tea, everything becomes consumer goods. It's only when I sell it in the market that we call milk and sugar as intermediate goods. That is, goods which are used to produce further goods and services for sale in the market. And they are different from capital goods, because capital goods are used over a long period of time. Intermediate goods get exhausted at the same time period. As in, say, take it as this. A car used as a taxi is a capital good, but the fuel we put in that car becomes intermediate. So that will get exhausted during the production process. The ink we are putting in this marker is an intermediate good. The electricity we are using in this classroom is an intermediate service. Why? Because this electricity is used for this classroom activity. All right, it is not for a personal purpose. And this electricity is completely getting exhausted as we are using it. And this is an intermediate expenditure for the firm called Vajiram. Alright, so that is why we call it an intermediate service. Just to bring it up to you, see, we distinguish the economic system into four sectors. Households, which is individuals, me, you, we are households. Firms, which are the production units. So it can be privately owned, it can be government owned. But if it is a production unit, it's a firm. Alright. Government, which will be administration, law and order, judiciary, and external sector. That is, everything that is not in my economic system, lies outside, is external. So we do all transactions or calculations of transactions based on these four sectors. Then we believe households are the ones who own factor services like land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. So land will be all natural resources that are available to you for usage. So it's not only land, it can be minerals, it can be the rivers and the mountains and all, that's land. Labor is the workers, houses, and the individuals. That's labor, skilled or unskilled, that's not the concern. Capital is the fund that you use to buy capital goods, machines and all, that's capital. And entrepreneurship is that those who organize all these together and then initiate a business. Take an example, the place where we are can be land, I can be labor for a firm called Vajiram. Capital is, or capital goods are, these boards and these screens and so on. An entrepreneur will be Ravindran sir, who organizes all this, runs an institute called Vajiram, and provides this service to the system. And there is land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. And all of them are rewarded for their services, like land will get rent, labor gets wages, capital gets interest, and the entrepreneur gets profit. Alright, that is how we run the system first. But apart from land, labor, capital, and entrepreneur, then you use secondary inputs, which are intermediate goods. Alright, apart from land, labor, capital, and entrepreneur, the secondary inputs will be these intermediate goods, like raw material, the electricity we use, the transportation services we provide. All that can be intermediate goods and services. Alright, now, suppose I have to calculate my GDP. So, and say for a second that these are the only three sectors in my economy, milk, sugar, and tea. Say the milk seller reports to me that I produce milk worth 30 rupees. And the sugar seller reported that I produce sugar worth 20 rupees. And the tea seller reports that I produce tea worth 100 rupees. Let's assume for the time being, assume that milk and sugar don't have a raw material use. They just are present in the economy. Now think, if I add all these three and say that all right, that the GDP of my economy is 30 plus 20 plus 100, that will not be correct. That will not be correct because 30 plus 20, I'm already adding the value of milk and sugar, plus 100 will mean in this 100, these values are again included. Because when I used these, produced tea, and sold it for 100, then the value of tea must have been including these values also. So what do I end up doing? I double count milk and sugar. And this will result in exaggerating my GDP. So what we do is, as soon as a commodity is used as an intermediate good, we exclude it from counting under GDP. Alright, in a sense, I take milk worth 30, no raw material used, so the value addition done by the milk seller was 30. Sugar worth 20, no raw material used, so the value addition done by sugar seller was 20. Tea worth 100, but he used raw material worth 50, so the value added by this tea seller is not 100 but 50. Because 50 rupees he was buying from the market, he added only 50 to this. So that means the total value addition in my economic system is 30 rupees by the milk seller, 20 rupees by the sugar seller and 50 rupees by the tea seller. When I add all these three, I get 100 rupees as the GDP. Now, I am excluding intermediate goods while calculating GDP, not because I don't